For the record, it is 5:15 PM on Thursday, May 12, 2016. Time for the regular meeting of the Wenatchee City Council. The first item would be the pledge to our flag. Councilmember Esparza, would you lead us in the pledge?
I will. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Councilmember Esparza. Roll call this evening. We have all seven council members present tonight. First item on our agenda would be consent items, which includes this evening's agenda, vouchers, and minutes from the previous meeting.
And I make a motion to approve the agenda, vouchers, and minutes from previous meetings, including all of the vouchers listed below.
Second.
Motion by Councilmember Huffaker, second by Councilmember Poyer to approve this evening's consent items, including the agenda, vouchers, and minutes from the previous meeting. Any discussion from the council? Hearing none. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carries. Thank you. Next item on our agenda this evening would be citizen comment. If you're here to talk about the fireworks ban, we'll allow public comment during that time period. If you have any other issues you wish to address the council about, this would be a time where you could do so. I just ask that you give us your name and address for the record. Seeing no takers, we will then move on to our, we have three quick presentations that we will do. One for Peace Officers Memorial Day Proclamation, one for Arts Education Month, and one for Public Works Week. So who has the Peace Officers Proclamation?
I do.
Councilmember Harold, would you read that into the record, please?
I'd be honored. Whereas the members of law enforcement agencies of North Central Washington play an essential role in safeguarding our rights and freedoms, and whereas it is important that all citizens know and understand the duties, responsibilities, hazards, and sacrifices of their law enforcement agency, and that members of our law enforcement agency recognize their duty to serve the people by safeguarding life and property, by protecting them against violence and disorder, and by protecting the innocent against deception and the weak against oppression. And whereas the men and women of the law enforcement agencies of North Central Washington unceasingly provide a vital public service. Now, therefore, I, Frank J. Kuntz, Mayor of the City of Wenatchee, call upon all citizens of North Central Washington and upon all patriotic, civic, and educational organizations to observe the week of May 15th through May 21st, 2016 as Police Week, with appropriate ceremonies and observances in which all of our people may join in commemorating law enforcement officers, past and present, who by their faithful and loyal devotion to their responsibilities have rendered a dedicated service to their communities, and in doing so have established for themselves an inviolable and enduring reputation for preserving the rights and security of all citizens. I further call upon all citizens of North Central Washington to observe May 15th, 2016 as Peace Officers Memorial Day in the City of Wenatchee in honor of those law enforcement officers who, through their courageous deeds, have made the ultimate sacrifice in service to their community or have become disabled in the performance of duty. And let us recognize and pay respect to the survivors of our fallen heroes. In witness whereof, I hereby set my hand and cause the seal of the City of Wenatchee to be affixed on this 12th day of May, 2016. Frank J. Kuntz, Mayor.
Thank you, Linda. Captain Reinfeld, Captain General, you guys representing the Peace Force today? Picture?
Very well.
Captain Reinfeld,
you got a
picture taken?
We
can picture. I don't have a
camera person.
Yes, we do.
Scrambling in there.
We are scrambling today.
Go ahead. I'd like to thank the city and the mayor and the city council for the recognition of this.
I'd like to thank the council and the mayor again for recognition of Police Week. It's a big deal. I personally have known two officers killed in the line, murdered in the line of duty, one that went to the academy right after me. And it's good to see the recognition and have people hopefully help understand what it means to us. So thank you very much.
And I don't have much to add, just thank you for being here. It's definitely a good thing to honor our officers, and thank you for being here. Thank you.
And the peace officers' lunch is next Wednesday?
The 18th.
Mm-hmm. Next Wednesday.
Next Wednesday.
At 11:30, I think. So if any of you would like to go, that's a great, great event to go to. Arts Education Month. Who's got that proclamation? Councilmember Markhart.
Okay, whereas the arts, including dance, music, theater, and visual arts, are defined as a core content area in Washington State's definition of basic education and considered an essential component of the complete education that should be provided for all students, and whereas learning in and through the arts enables students to develop critical thinking and problem-solving skills, imagination, and creativity, discipline, alternative ways to communicate and express feelings and ideas, and cross-cultural understanding, which supports academic success across the curriculum as well as personal growth outside the classrooms, and whereas imagination and creativity are increasingly understood as critical capacities needed for success in the 21st century workforce, and whereas the arts can transform schools into havens of creativity and exploration, places where students want to learn, teachers want to teach, and all members of the learning community are more engaged and motivated, and whereas high-quality school-based arts education involves a wide range of partners, including school boards, district administrators, educators, parents, artists, and arts organizations, community members, and local businesses and organizations whose collective endeavors toward equitable provision of arts learning for all students we celebrate and promote, and whereas we applaud the efforts and dedication of the arts educators and advocates around the state, and we call for school and community leaders to continue to broaden and strengthen their commitment to provide arts education for every student in every school. Whereas the City of Wenatchee is invested in encouraging art through the work of the Arts Wenatchee Arts Commission and 1% for the Arts Fund, and whereas the Wenatchee Arts Recreation and Parks Commission would like to command and support the work of the Wenatchee School District for their efforts, which include Beauty of Bronze Elementary Art Education Program, the District Art Show, the Strong String Band Programs that provide annual musicals, and district-wide musicals that rival professional shows seen in much larger venues. I, Frank J. Kuntz, Mayor of City of Wenatchee, do hereby proclaim the month of May as Arts Education Month in the City of Wenatchee, and I urge all citizens to join us in the special observance. In witness whereof, I hereby set my hand and cause a seal of the City of Wenatchee to be affixed on this 12th day of May, 2016. Frank J. Kuntz, Mayor.
Thank you, Councilmember Marker. Anybody from the arts group here today?
Don?
Oh, yes, sir. Come on. Over there. How are you?
Well, how about yourself? Thank you. See you. You bet.
Oh, come on up. We're getting a picture taken.
Over
here.
You're
on Facebook.
Oh. Something new. Facebook.
Thanks for your work for the Arts Commission.
Thank you very much. I'd like to also invite the council and Mayor Kuntz and the public here to next week's Wenatchee All District Arts Festival. It will be held at Wenatchee High School in the Commons. Starts at 5:30. Come and see the music and the visual arts and have a great time supporting students in the schools. Thank you.
Thank you. Eastern. And not excluding any arts, if you haven't seen Mary Poppins yet, you must go. I went last night and that thing was absolutely off the charts good.
Amazing how great of talent we have in this valley. Ah,
off the charts. I'm singing supercalifragilisticexpialidocious all day today.
Well, that's good, let's hear it.
No, I'm stopping there. Public Works, Keith.
Okay. Whereas public works infrastructure facilities services are of vital importance to sustaining communities and to the health, safety, and well-being of the people of Wenatchee, and whereas such facilities and services could not be provided without the dedicated efforts of public works professionals, engineers, managers, employees from state and local government and the private sector who are responsible for and must plan, design, build, operate and maintain the transportation, water supply, water treatment, and solid waste systems, public buildings, and other structures and facilities essential to serve our citizens. And whereas it is in the public's interest for the citizens, civic leaders, and children in the United States to gain knowledge of and to maintain a progressive interest and understand the importance of public works and public works programs in their respective communities. And whereas 2016 marks the 56th annual National Public Works Week, sponsored by the American Public Works Association. Now, therefore, I, Frank Kuntz, Mayor of the City of Wenatchee, do hereby proclaim the week of May 15th through the 21st, 2016, as Public Works Week in the City of Wenatchee, and I urge all people in our community to join me in honoring our public works professionals, engineers, managers, employees, and recognizing the substantial contributions they have made to our national health, safety, welfare, and quality of life. In witness whereof, I hereby set my hand and cause the seal of the City of Wenatchee to be affixed on this 12th day of May, 2016. Frank J. Kuntz, Mayor.
Thank you, Councilmember Huffaker. Matt Leonard, you coming up for the public works, folks?
What do you have? We got a little poster, a logo, the saying this year is always there for our public works week.
Oh, cool. You guys are all always there. It's like our police department, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, right?
Yeah, we have really dedicated staff. It's really great to be part of this group. All right.
Hold the poster up.
Cover yourself.
All right, thank you.
Thanks.
All right, thank you.
They don't seek recognition.
And the council knows we'll be barbecuing hamburgers on Tuesday for the public works folks. If you're out at public works next Tuesday, we'll
next Tuesday.
Yeah, we'll make sure we get that on your schedule. All right, we have one action item before we get to the public hearing item. So the first action item is regarding ordinance 2016-11 regarding the Public Works Economic Development Committee. Allison Williams.
Good evening. Allison Williams, Executive Services Director. At your last meeting, you talked about the addition of this committee. And so this is simply a housekeeping item to add it to your council procedures. And so this ordinance 2016-11 would add a public works / economic development committee. And currently it is adding council members to the every other week meeting that is being held out at the Public Services Center with the public works directors and Steve, Mr. Economic Development, Steve King.
And we had our first meeting with the council members last Tuesday. So council member Esparza and council member Poyer both attended. So I'm glad you guys were able to make it. Hopefully it was informative.
Very.
So we would entertain a motion if we had one.
Well, Your Honor, I make a motion to adopt ordinance number 2016-11, amending ordinance number 2013-06. Codified at Chapter 1.07 WCC by the addition of a Public Works Economic Development Committee.
Second.
Motion by Councilmember Esparza, second by Councilmember Harrell to adopt Ordinance Number 2016-11, creating the Public Works Economic Development Committee of the Council. Any questions or comments for the record? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Thanks, Allison.
Yes.
All right, next on our agenda is a public hearing item regarding fireworks and regulating the sale, possession, and use thereof. City of Wenatchee public hearings will be go like this. We'll hear from city staff. The council can ask questions of staff. Once we're done, we'll turn it over to the members of the audience that would like to address the council. We'd ask that you have 3 minutes and give us your name and address for the record. And when we're done with that, we'll turn it back over to the council for any action they may be willing to take. So I guess at this point, we'll turn it over to the city attorney, Steve Smith.
Good evening, Mayor, City Council, Steve Smith, city attorney. This matter is ordinance number 2016-10, and it's relating to the regulations of the sale, possession, and use of fireworks, and would repeal our existing code on fireworks. Our current code provides that within the city, fireworks, the sale, use, and possession of fireworks, or in discharge of fireworks, is prohibited except for a few days around the 4th of July holiday and the New Year's Day holiday. Just generally from about June 28th to July 4th, and then December 27th to January 1st. It's permitted, otherwise prohibited. The proposed ordinance would make the possession and use of fireworks prohibited in the city at all times for personal use. There would be some uses allowed by permit. That would be public displays and certain manufacturing, production, storing, that sort of thing at the wholesale level. And then there would also be agricultural uses and wildlife control uses that would be allowed. Violations would be punished. First violation is a class one civil infraction, which carries a $250 fine plus statutory assessments, which almost double that. So it's a pretty significant fine. Second, subsequent violations would be misdemeanors, which is actually a criminal violation and could be punished by a 90-day jail term and or $1,000 fine. So the proposed ordinance would essentially ban personal use and possession of fireworks.
This would take effect, assuming if it was to pass, we have a 1 year waiting period, is that correct?
That's correct, yes. So the effective date is 1 year from passage and publication. So it would be roughly mid-June 2017.
So nothing would change for this particular 4th of July or this particular New Year's Eve in terms of our abilities under the law?
That's correct.
How does it work for a minor, for the second offense, for a misdemeanor? You're not going to put an 8-year-old in jail, so how does it work?
Well, they would be prosecuted as a juvenile, which they have different rules, but it's still a misdemeanor offense, but they have different penalty assessments where they have diversion programs and that sort of thing.
You speaking from experience, or is there something you want to share with the group?
I'm kind of curious. You know, are the parents responsible? You know, how does that? You know, I'm not sure how exactly.
Well, a parent wouldn't be necessarily responsible for a child mm-hmm. unless they were, you know, violating the law themselves. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so a child in possession or using fireworks could be held liable under the code.
That would be the same with any other sort of laws that we have, correct?
That's true, yeah.
Similar. Not inconsistent with other.
Yeah. Alcohol use, driving infractions, that sort of thing.
So, Steve, I have a question. We have pockets of county within the city. We also have properties above Western that are county and that are literally landlocked. The only way in is through the city. Are we infringing upon their right to, because the county is not prohibiting fireworks, are we infringing upon their rights to have fireworks?
Well, we don't have any jurisdiction over the county property. So if they have fireworks within a county island or an area within that's surrounded by city, we don't have any jurisdiction over that. So our code wouldn't apply to that. The only issue might be that we are banning possession. So technically they, you know, if they have to drive through town to get to their property, that could be an issue. That came up, I think, the last time we brought this forward about a year ago, that the possession issue, it is a problem, you know, but the police have a couple of factors there. One, they have trouble enforcing this without a possession element because they rarely catch the people doing it. It's more of a catching them in possession of the materials. So they want a possession element, yet you do have situations where somebody might be passing through town, for instance, in possession, but no intent to use it. So, that's kind of a conflict, a problem that it's hard to reconcile. And the police chief, as I recall, sat here and said that they would use their discretion and, you know, they're not going to be out there looking for people that are just in possession of fireworks. It's just a tool, you know, where they've got evidence that they're using it, but they only catch them in possession.
So under normal circumstances, if I'm driving down the road and I have illegal fireworks in my trunk and I get pulled over for speeding, There's no reason that the police officer is going to look in my trunk.
What if they're in the back of your car, like in, you know, within?
Yeah. They could be there, yeah. And I don't know if that's enough to cause someone to go into a car and do stuff. I mean, it's not a huge issue, but we're not going to be out looking for it if it shows up.
Yeah, the police chief just indicated that their position would be to use their discretion and not cite in that situation. Not to say it couldn't happen, but, you know, like, that's where we have to use our discretion. I mean, the point here is to not get people passing through town or carrying it in their back seat. It's to prevent them from using it when they shouldn't be.
In other cities...
How do you know? I mean, somebody, let's say me, I live within the city. I go to East Wenatchee because East Wenatchee also doesn't prohibit, you know, the sale and possession of fireworks. They don't have anything prohibiting it. I go over there because I want to go over to Cashmere to light up fireworks in Cashmere on the 4th of July. And I forgot something at home. I have to go back home. I have to go through the city to get to home, and I get pulled over with a bunch of fireworks in the back of my car. I have no intention whatsoever to light them up within the city of Wenatchee.
Yeah, I understand.
Yeah.
But the other cities that have done this, Spokane bans possession, most of the ones that have been successful in dealing with the issues ban possession.
Yeah, this proposed ordinance mimics the Spokane ordinance almost verbatim. And my understanding is they've had it for about 25 years, and as far as I know, it's gone okay.
Thank you. Any other questions for the city attorney while we have him in front of us?
Yes, Steve, I'm a little not clear, I guess, on the use of fireworks for agriculture or wildlife, you know, purpose, I assume, scaring off something in the orchards or whatever. Is that allowed outright, or does that have to go through the permit process?
That is allowed outright. Consistent with state law. They don't have to have a permit for that from us.
Okay. Is there, I guess I'm not aware of that going on. It just kind of struck me as a bit odd having that in there. Does it need to be in there?
Well, it's historically been in there. The I think, you know, during, say, cherry season, for instance, you hear the pops. I think they may at one time use fireworks. Now I think they have these cherry guns that go off kind of automatically, and they're not fireworks. They're more of a firearm, like a blank shotgun shell that goes off. So, but when we wrote this up, I think the idea was to not restrict what they've historically done. Whether they still do it or not, I don't know.
If they're not doing it, it's not a problem, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, any other questions for our city attorney while we have him in front of us? All right. Thank you, Mr. Smith. Just don't go to Washington. Stay here. All right. So we will entertain any members of the audience that wish to address the council. We would, how many people want to address the council? Get a showing of hands. Okay. We got a few folks. So we'll give you each 3 minutes. We ask again your name and address for the record. If someone else is saying the same thing you're saying, if you just want to say, I support that person, that might make it go a little bit faster. But we'll allot whatever time is necessary for everybody to address the council. Maria, you'll have the little clicker going, and you'll hear a little ding, ding, ding when you get pretty close to your 3 minutes. Is that right?
Yes.
Perfect. All right. So we'll just, whoever wants to go first, come on up. And does that mean you're coming up, or you're just going to record?
Oh.
All right.
I'd like to leave.
Thank you, Shiloh.
Hi, everyone.
Hi, Shiloh.
Hi. Shiloh Shower. I'm here today on behalf of the Independence Day Celebration Committee. I'm really here to offer myself as a resource to the council if you have any questions about this year's festival and your consideration of this. The committee has no position on this ordinance. I want to make that very clear. So our address, I guess I'll give, is 9 North or 9 South Wenatchee Avenue, which is the Community Foundation's address, because that's our only place. So if you have any questions about the celebration or what we're doing that I can offer as information for you guys and your consideration for this, I want to make myself available to do that on behalf of the committee.
The same plan as last year, so to speak?
Same plan as last year, yeah. Maybe a little bigger and better. We'll see. Still waiting to hear if we're going to get a naturalization ceremony or not. The community, the federal agency that does that is short-staffed, so Norma and us have put in that request. to do that. We're excited. We've got some new community groups partnering with us. The circus is going to be down there, the youth circus, and they're going to be running parking as a fundraiser for us, which is fantastic. So we're looking for some additional opportunities to partner with local entities to help them raise funds for their causes, whatever that may be.
If there was some non-for-profits that may have been selling legal fireworks at the time, and if we make them illegal, they would be able to perhaps have a booth of some variety down there.
Yeah, last year, I think it might have been the Appalachians that normally do a 50-50 raffle in conjunction with a fireworks stand or something that they have, and they had no way to do that. And so we offered them a booth at no charge, actually, and helped them through the evening and the day promote that raffle and then announce the winner that night. So we were able to do that. We're still building what the festival looks like each year, so there's definitely an opportunity. And the more community groups or community members we get involved, the easier it is to run that thing. So 15,000 people coming down to one spot is a good captive audience. So if we can leverage that for some good in our community, I think that fits the spirit of what this place is all about. So
fundraising going well?
Yeah, we're about to launch our public fundraising. So corporate fundraising, we're two-thirds to our goal. We actually have all of the money secure for this year's festival, but as you may recall, the overall goal for us is to raise enough money in reserves to be 1 year consistently ahead, and it costs us about $60,000 a year to do this, to provide all of the, you know, health and safety stuff as well as the show itself and stage rental equipment and all that good fun things that goes into planning a festival. So we're about to launch a $20,000 public individual campaign here in the next couple weeks. We'll be talking about that on the radio, and letters will be going out to small business owners. But I'm very pleased to say that not only with the City of Wenatchee and East Wenatchee's annual $5,000 support, that our corporate sponsors have been very strong. So we've raised over $40,000 in corporate sponsorship and the city sponsorship for that. So we're sitting good, and we had about $30,000 left over last year's fundraising goal. So we're there, but we want to continue that momentum to get people moving and used to donating. We say if everybody uses a dollar or invests a dollar, we have fireworks. So that's what we want to do.
Great.
I'm hearing city the buzz. Does that mean I'm off the hook?
I don't know. Is that the buzzer?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Okay. That's time. City of East Wenatchee.
My phone was ringing.
Definitely, yeah, involved, and
they're fantastic, and they're supporting with their $5,000 contribution. And we're still looking for ways that make sense for their community to have an arm of doing something over there. Last year, we had the youth circus over there in Eastmont Park. The youth circus wanted to move to Walla Walla Point Park this year, so we're doing that. So helping them with that, but they're still figuring out if there's an opportunity for them to do something else connected to that day. So we're working with all of our partners. Pybus, for example, will continue to have their cherry pit spit contest, and Cashew Valley Bank will have their pancake breakfast down there again, and we have the run happening and these things that are becoming traditions now that other entities are doing in conjunction with the events that start at 4 o'clock at the park.
Thank you.
Yeah. Great.
Thank you, Shiloh.
Excellent.
Appreciate you being here.
You betcha.
You can go now.
All right, who's next?
My name is Lori Nichols. I live at 3635 Birchvale Road in Wenatchee. Although I'm not in the city limits, I am very concerned about the fireworks because, of course, as we know, embers can fly. And so I am for banning the fireworks. My understanding is most wildfires are human caused, and either intentionally or unintentionally. And I believe we need to reduce the risk any way we can. I'm a retired RN, and that's what I did for 40 years, was reducing risk and health and safety. So I look at it, we're talking not just potentially losing homes, but lives and people's fun, okay? And traditions really should not be allowed to put others at risk. And I am counting on you as our city council here to make sure that public safety is number one. I worry about our fire department, our police department, our police officers, our emergency people. I want them to be able to deal with have the time to deal with the fires that are, you know, lightning and arson, but let's reduce the risk so we don't have to worry about having these fireworks as a potential risk. Well, that's it.
Great. Lori, thank you so much for being here this evening. Brian, were you next? You kind of got up and we're heading this way. So
we're working this way.
Yeah. Maybe we'll put everyone in the hot seat right there in front and we can just kind of work
on,
our way
on deck.
It.
On deck and in the hole. Here we go.
Brian Campbell, 1837 Jefferson Street. I am, and not for the ban as proposed, I'll read something from last year that I stated. If the problem that we're attempting to solve is the damage caused by fireworks on the 4th of July due to the high heat and tinder dry fuels, how does banning fireworks on New Year's Eve contribute to solving that problem? Possession of aerial fireworks is already illegal, but law enforcement is suggesting that a total ban on safe and sane fireworks should also be investigated or instigated so that enforcement's made easier. Right now, they can already enforce possession of illegal fireworks, and that is most of the fires that are caused by fireworks are illegal aerial fireworks. Safe and sane sparklers aren't generally the cause. I believe that if people can still celebrate their freedom in a safe manner on New Year's Eve, there would be voluntary compliance with a partial ban in the summer. That played out perfectly last year. There was a ban that was placed, even though it didn't have legal basis, and there was great compliance by the public. So I don't think that we have a real problem. If you ban them just in the summer, that's one thing, but banning them in the winter, you know, that what are you trying to solve? The other, also the statement that was made that we didn't ban the use of fireworks last year and then we almost burned down our city is totally irrelevant and inappropriate. Assuming the Wenatchee World article is accurate and not taken out of context, and that's a big assumption, maybe we should have also banned not only lightning, but Bic lighters, because there weren't any fireworks related problems last year. Eliminating them in the wintertime is really not necessary. And the banning the possession is the part that's really irritating, that if somebody's driving through town, like you say, on the way to the county and has some sparklers they want to set off with their kids, that law is just not necessary. The police already have the right with the illegal aerial fireworks to stop them from being set off and also possessing them. And when I was a reserve officer, we actually found two people that were setting off illegal aerial fireworks, and they didn't take any action anyway. So I don't think we're really solving a problem if we're trying to ban them in the winter and banning possession.
So Brian, just to be clear, you are okay with a ban in the summer?
Yeah, I think it causes some other problems if surrounding jurisdictions don't get on board. But still, that makes sense in the summertime, sending fireworks off. There is just a huge risk with the tinder dry conditions. So I'm not saying that shouldn't be considered. That has a lot of common sense associated with that. It's the wintertime and the possession that I have a problem with.
Thank you.
All right, who's next? Yes, sir.
My name is Bob Acklin, a pastor. I live at 805 Grandview, Wenatchee. I pastor Living Word Church of God. Our church has had a fundraiser at Albertson since the store was built. I don't know how many years that is. I am for the citizens' right to celebrate the 4th of July by shooting personal fireworks. I am for that. Whether our church would do it as a fundraiser or not, I look at it as a tradition that means a lot to America. On the other hand, I am concerned. I've lived in Wenatchee since 1974. I came from a wet environment, Longview. What strikes me is this is a desert. We have fires here every year. Mostly lightning and man-made. I don't know how many fireworks caused it has been. I know there's a lot of concern, maybe hysteria, but I last year I was on the border of hysteria too. I would like to see the citizens' right. There's thousands of people in this community, citizens that buy fireworks. They also support money and build the parks. And I'd like to see a compromise worked out that maybe sell the fireworks for 3 days or 2 days and shoot for one. That would help control it, enforce it, help our police force. I'd like to see the city open up city parks. I've made this suggestion before, but the answer I get is we can't do that because of insurance reasons. And I say, why? A kid might get burned. We have a swimming pool they can drown in. We have skateboard they can break their neck in. So that really doesn't, that doesn't make sense to me. It doesn't serve as an answer. But so basically, I'd like to see some kind of a compromise worked out that safe and sane fireworks could be used here. That's it.
Thank you, Bob. Thank you for being here this evening. Yes, ma'am.
Hello, my name is Julie Smith. My family has made Wenatchee our home for the past 18 years at the address of 2038 Maiden Lane. My husband and I have raised our children here and consider Wenatchee our home, as I said. I'm in strong support of the ban on fireworks in Wenatchee. The fact is that fire danger and the risk of fire in our region has increased and continues to increase. Fire season is already upon us, with two fire evacuations this past week, one in Antioch and one in the Leavenworth area. This is 2 months prior to previous slated start of fire season in the city of Wenatchee. From a report from the National Fire Protection Association, in 2011, fireworks caused in the United States an estimated 17,800 fires, including 1,200 structure fires, 400 vehicle fires, and 16,300 outside and other fires. These fires alone resulted in over $32 million in direct property damage. In 2013, U.S. emergency rooms treated over 11,000 people for fireworks-related injuries, with the greatest number of young children between the ages of 0 to 2, greatest risk in the children between 0 and 2, and the second highest risk in the children 10 to 14. And actually, in that report, 41% of the cause of those injuries was sparklers, not aerial fireworks. Spring and summertime temperatures in north central Washington are increasing. Our snowpack is melting at a faster rate, and the number of fires we are seeing as a community in our state, in our region, and in our country are increasing in size. Total loss, destruction of homes, destructions of businesses, and forest land and resources used. The ban on the fireworks in Wenatchee seems a no-brainer to me. We live in fire country. The risk and causes of fires are complex issues with many parts. Mitigating and preventing man-caused fires are extremely important, impacting not only ourselves but our larger community. There's just too much at risk. My family was one of the families that lost our home on the night of June 28, 2015 to the Sleepy Hollow fire. Although the cause of that particular fire was not due to fireworks, it was human-caused, man-made, man-caused. The pace of the Sleepy Hollow fire and its speed in travel was aided by dry fuel, hot temperatures, and high winds. These environmental factors are realities, and we will continue to see these in our new landscape. We will see again and again dry fuel, hot temperatures, and high winds. So this is how I see things now and how I see things for the indefinite future. This is going to take all of us, not just the city council. This takes all of us as individuals, as families, as neighborhoods, and the greater community to do what we can do to work together for the common good. Our group situational awareness has become hyper acute to many issues, including the risk of fire in our valley, but also the prevention of fire. Let's not have the events of last June 28th repeat themselves for any reason whatsoever. Let's not allow this to happen to the community we dearly love. The fire-related events occurring right now to our neighbors in the north in Canada could easily be our reality. I know what it was like to evacuate Broadview that evening. I cannot imagine evacuating a city. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Dr. Smith. Appreciate you being here this evening. Who's next?
My name is Penelope Tobiska. I live at 1618 Central Avenue in Wenatchee. I concur. I won't repeat what Julie Smith said. I concur with everything that she said. I'd like to bring up one other additional issue, and this is usually it's illegal fireworks, but still there's so much, I think, illegal and legal fireworks are set off at the same time. That is noise, because as the years have gone on, there are more and more explosions going off in Wenatchee. I live in the north end, and some of them are very close to home. Certainly, it disturbs animals, but they are going on until 12, 1 o'clock at night. And I think that that is an issue that could be addressed too. Nobody has brought it up, but it is difficult for families, children to sleep, animals, people who have jobs that they have to get up for at 4:30 in the morning. So that is an issue. Anyway, I agree with Julie, and I am for the ban on the fireworks. Thank you.
Thank you, Penelope, for being here this evening. Who's next? Yes, sir.
Hi, my name is Kevin New. I live at 722 Highland Drive here in Wenatchee. And I just got a little thing I like to read, and just like to also make sure it's clear that when we say fireworks, we're talking about safe and sane fireworks, what you're wanting to ban, because the other ones are already banned, if I'm not mistaken. Okay. So most people who want to ban safe and sane fireworks want to ban them just to ban them. They don't actually look into the facts. If they did, they would know that deep frying turkeys causes more house fires than the type of fireworks we're talking about here tonight. To say no to the responsible use of safe and sane fireworks ever again, I believe, is an overreaction. Just because something is misused by a small minority does not mean it should be banned. If this were true, we would have to ban cars, turkey fryers, firearms, lighters, and so much more. So if you're thinking is that we just can't take a chance with safe and sane fireworks, where does it end? I have seen no data yet that supports the notion that this proposed ban is necessary. It seems that the light of patriotism is growing dimmer and dimmer. I'm afraid that it will be gone completely someday with all the politically correct feel-good decisions that are made. It would seem that there is a lot of hysteria here without cause. The fires that have affected our area were not caused by the responsible use of safe and sane fireworks. We commemorate Independence Day by setting off fireworks because one of our founding fathers, John Adams, wanted us to. He envisioned fireworks as part of the festivities. The first Independence Day fireworks were set off on July 4th, 1777. My family continues the tradition unto this day. Aerial fireworks are already illegal. The proposed ban on safe and sane fireworks seems to be a feel-good thing, although in reality it does nothing. All this will do is force people into the black market. Nobody on the black market will sell safe and sane fireworks. If we need to do anything here tonight, it should be to find a way to enforce the laws on the illegal use of aerial fireworks and drastically increase the penalties for the use of already illegal aerial fireworks. There are many other options besides a ban on safe and sane fireworks. Not all of us are able to attend the community firework display. Even if I could every year, I would still want to gather with my family and show my kids how to responsibly use safe and sane fireworks. I hope that before you even consider this proposed ban, that you would educate yourselves on the actual facts of the responsible use of safe and sane fireworks. On behalf of my family and myself, we humbly ask that you reject this proposed ban. Please don't take the responsible use of safe and sane fireworks away from my family.
Thank you, Kevin. Appreciate you being here this evening.
Yeah, thank you, guys.
Hi, I'm Elaine Brown. I live at 1955 Castle Rock Avenue here in Wenatchee. I'd like to thank the City Council for looking into this ordinance again. I was very disappointed last year when it didn't happen. I really appreciate the fact that this council is taking the lead amongst the agencies and the communities around us. And I think if you go forward with this, perhaps the other areas would go forward with it also. I will concur with what the emergency service lady, the nurse, said, and also the woman that lost her home. The things she said are very powerful, and I'd appreciate this council acting on this ordinance tonight.
Thank you. Thanks, Elaine.
Evening. My name is Larry Tobiska. I'd like to ask the council to vote in favor of the ordinance. If I could, I would make it effective June 1 this year instead of next year. I'd like to, I'll just say that I too agree with the things that Julie Smith has indicated to you concerning safety and the fire danger. of fireworks in this community. A couple other points, however. I think it is a sufficient reason in and of itself to ban the fireworks to protect the psychological welfare of animals in the community, because it kind of drives them nuts. And as they are driven nuts, their owners are driven nuts. And I've experienced that and don't want to experience it again. So I think that we're doing a good thing for our citizens and the animals in our community if we ban these fireworks. Another point seems to me that should be made is that to shift the opportunity to blow off these fireworks to January 1st, I think would be a mistake. If we don't ban them, period, that may become a point of concentration, sale, emphasis, and expression by people that would be troubling as well, not only to fellow citizens and to animals. I don't think that we promote patriotism by blowing off fireworks. I think a better way in which we promote patriotism is to have regard for the concerns and welfare of members of the community who are troubled by this practice. So I again would ask the council to favor this ordinance and pass it as soon as possible. Thank you.
Thanks, Larry. Appreciate you being here this evening. Who's in the batter's box? See, and you had a Seattle Mariners shirt and I used batter's box.
Good batter and difference. You got to be a fan.
My name's Lori Nelson. I live at 933 Coolidge in Wenatchee here. For the record, I was born and raised in this area. I was raised in Leavenworth. We used to have fireworks down Blackbird Island growing up and stuff during the 4th of July. We had fireworks in the streets. We had the bucket of water. We wet everything down around us. Didn't have a problem. I grew up going through college, working for the Forest Service. I've worked as an ambulance EMT for 9 years, half of it up north and half down here with Ballard. I've been a nurse for 18 years and stuff, and worked in critical care here at Central Washington Hospital and stuff. And, you know, I'm totally against the ban. I'm not sure why the ban and stuff. I look at people and I wonder, you know, we grew up as kids having the fireworks. Independence Day, the celebration of it. Which one of all of us don't remember the excitement of having sparklers or having the little cones or going down with your parents to pick up these things and be able to have a good time legally and stuff with the fireworks, same fireworks, and celebrate it. I have dogs. I have no issues with them because I proactively take care of them because I know the fireworks and stuff. So I don't agree with that at least either and stuff. You know, as far as safety, if people are proactive, like me growing up, as all of us, I think, were taught growing up around fireworks, is not to have it around trees, to have water available, do it in a safe place. You know, have people lost their minds as far as being able to be proactive and just want to ban things and take it away from your kids because people have gotten the fear of God set in them? You know, and now it's like, now you're dumping that on the fellow kids of yours, your grandkids and stuff. What do you tell them that, you know, because of other generations or whatever, the fear of house fires, the fear of this, whatever, we're telling you, you can't celebrate it with fireworks anymore. We did, had no problem, but you can't. I don't get that and stuff with people and stuff. You know, it's like people have lost their minds. There's safe ways to do it. You're not going to ban people going out getting illegal fireworks. That's not going to happen. You may push them to the outskirts of the city if you're lucky and stuff, but that's going to continue regardless of what you want to do. They'll still, if not more people, go get illegal fireworks and bring them into the city. The only thing you're taking away from are the kids that have learned history about Independence Day and everything, the kids and their family teaching them how to do it appropriately. You punish the kids for what?
I'm
stuff. Sorry.
But thank you, Lori. Appreciate you being here this evening. Who's in the batter's deck?
Hi, my name is Diane Young. I live at 2105 Yarrow Road, Wenatchee. And I appreciate the council looking at this fireworks ban again this year. And hopefully that will it will get passed. I support the ban. I am very concerned about the fireworks and the dry conditions that we have. I do not feel that fireworks show patriotism. I think that you show patriotism in a lot of other ways, but not through fireworks. And I am concerned. I agree with what Mrs. Smith had to say about the statistics. I also read those statistics on the fire prevention or fire protection website. And thank you for taking a look at this.
Thanks, Diane. Appreciate you being here. Mr. McComas, how are you this evening?
Good. How are
Long
you?
Time no see.
I'm Doug McComas, 1920 Dorner Place, and I, nearly 50 years living in Wenatchee, have seen much destruction from fireworks, so I really appreciate that the council is considering a ban and strongly urge you to pass it. I have seen more than one fire caused by non-aerial fireworks, kids allowed to play out where there's burnable area, and I saw one fire sweep up the hill toward my house. I thought my house was surely gone, and all it was fireworks going off, firecrackers going off in the grass down below that set it up the hill. So I strongly support legislation or your law that would stop that from happening, or at least reduce the amount of it that would happen. So thank you for considering it.
Thank you, Mr. McComas, for being here this evening. Anybody else wish to address the council?
Good evening. My name is Marty Schmoker. I do not live in the city of Wenatchee. I live in Leavenworth, 12220 Sprumberg Canyon Road. I've set off professional fireworks shows since I was 16 years old, hold a pyro license for doing such and so forth. Had fireworks stands myself. To answer your question about your agricultural stuff, you have to have a license in order to purchase those types of things. So it's just not a blanket thing. You can go down to your local hardware store and get flash crackers and shoot them at your bears and so on and so forth. I'm not in favor of this ban. I think that we're reaching out more and more and more, that people are paranoidly scared about what might happen. I'm a contract firefighter also. I was on the Sleepy Hollow fire, one of the first people called to that as a contractor. I was also on the Chelan fire, and we saw what happened from that. I think it's irresponsible reporting on both the paper and other news sources with the fact that we don't want to repeat next or last year with a fireworks ban. Those fires were not caused by fireworks. I think it goes to the testimony of this entire county when they were asked to restrain from using fireworks last year. And I never saw but one aerial shell being shot during the 4th of July celebration here in Wenatchee. We were on the river with the Douglas County patrol boat, and that person was apprehended within 5 minutes of that shell going off. So you ask the people here to be responsible, they are responsible. But you're taking their right away to celebrate how they feel they need to celebrate New Year for 4th of July. I would propose something to you. If we're looking at the banning of fireworks because of fire problems, then let's ban them on the 4th, but let aerials be for New Year's. Let everything that is available out there to be shot. If we're looking at just strictly the fire industry of we don't want fires, then we don't have a problem with that in the wintertime. And then open it up to people to let them celebrate how they would like to for that. The other thing that I was kind of surprised that unless they're incognito, we don't have representation from the fire departments here today. It was with the meeting last year when the fire council was here giving their testimony, they said that they figured that 30 to 35% of the fires could be not happen. Well, that's their job, is to go put fires out, whether they're man-caused or not man-caused. That's their job. That's a profession that they've chosen to do. And so let's let them do their job without restricting people from what they're able to do. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Smoker, for being here this evening.
My name is Mike Brown. I live at 1955 Castle Rock. I'm here to speak in support of banning the fireworks. I'm a retired fire chief. In fact, I was the fire chief in Wenatchee for 10 years, many years ago. Fireworks are dangerous. Fireworks cause fires. They hurt our children. Every year, we're sending children to the hospitals for taking care of. It just does not make sense to me that we would have something that is so dangerous that they are banned 360 days of the year and then expect we're going to allow children to play with them for one day or a couple days and not expect that they're going to get injured. They're not professionals. They don't know how to operate them, and they're going to get hurt. I'm also a veteran. I'm very patriotic, and I encourage us all to use the professional displays so that we can celebrate our independence and also the 4th of July and our patriotism. I appreciate you taking up this ordinance, but I strongly, on behalf of all the fire services, we encourage you to ban the sale and use and discharge of fireworks. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Brown. Thank you for being here this evening. Anybody else wish to address the council before I turn it over to the council for their action? Hi, Leslie, how are you?
Hello, everyone, and I'm here. My name is Leslie Freitag. I reside at 2051 Broadleaf Court, and I'm here to support Julie Smith and her comments, and thank you to reconsider this ban. We live in a very dry, hot environment, and that is not changing, and anything that we can do to prevent man-made fires of any kind is something that we should consider, and especially in light that we're going back to now having festivals that we can all come together as a community to celebrate the 4th of July. Thank you for your consideration.
Thank you, Leslie. Thank you for being here. Anybody else wish to address the council? Yes, sir.
My name is Jerry Farley. I live in 16526 Shore Drive, Northeast Lake Forest Park, Washington. I'm the government affairs person for one of the large fireworks companies in the state of Washington. I drove over this morning to testify. Prohibition. It was a constitutional amendment. It was countrywide. It failed. And by the way, it gave us the mafia and organized crime. The war on drugs, it unleashed the scourge of heroin, methamphetamine, and all kinds of other drug abuse. And by the way, we now have legal wineries, so obviously prohibition didn't work, and we also have legal marijuana. So you have to be careful what you're gonna get after. And by the way, just remember, anything you pass has no effect upon tribal lands. And therefore, what this will do is encourage people who wanna get fireworks to go there. And by the way, they will buy things that are not legal under state law, let alone things that are not legal under your ordinance. I've been involved in this thing for over 30 years, and when I first started, the legal industry constituted about 50% of the industry. Right now, we're down to about 20%, and the quantity of fireworks sold in this state has quadrupled. Where are those sales occurring? I just told you. You're not going to be able to ban fireworks. In fact, it's a mistake, because what you do is you lose the opportunity to have a partnership with the legal industry that's local. That's people who want to care about the community, the safety of the community. Last year, your citizens showed that they have extraordinary common sense. They bought less, they bought different, or they didn't buy. And the retailers acted responsibly as well. This year, rain is about one-third above last year, above normal. And obviously, we know snowpack is substantially above. In fact, when I came over today, the Wenatchee River is just full. So last year was an unusual year. It doesn't happen very often. I urge you to take a step back from something that will not work, hasn't worked anywhere else. It doesn't work in the communities I live in, I can guarantee you that. And rethink a partnership with the legal industry that shares your concern about the safety of your citizens, but also believes that people should have the right, the First Amendment right of free speech, to celebrate the 4th of July. Texas v. Johnson. Mr. Johnson was an anarchist, a communist, hated the United States, burned the United States flag. And the Supreme Court said that he was protected in that First Amendment right of free speech. So if this were passed, you could burn the flag, but you couldn't shoot a cone or a fountain or light a sparkler. That's just simply wrong. It's wrong.
Oh, your time is just wrapping up, so.
I'd like to say one more thing. I would take the opportunity to disagree with your legal counsel on the interstate commerce issue. There's no discretion. You can buy fireworks wherever they're legal, and you can drive them anywhere. You can drive them through the communities. The problem is when you get off any road. So if you're going to do, in your instance, the example you gave, just park your car on the street. Don't go across the driveway into your private property, because that's where possession would obtain. But as long as it's in your car and private and transportation, you're protected and exempt by Interstate Commerce Clause.
Thank you. Thank you for being here this evening.
Any questions?
Oh, we've got a couple more people. Come on up into the, you got the batter's box up here.
Good evening. My name is Becky Berger. I'm from Spokane, Washington, 2122 East Lincoln Road. I met some of you last year. I work with the nonprofit groups and organizations that sell fireworks for fundraisers. And I guess the things that I would like to point out based upon testimony today is Spokane ban does not work. I know the fire officials would like you to think that. But I live in the county, right adjacent to the city, in one of those little pockets that you were discussing earlier, and there's fireworks going off all around. Unfortunately, the police are too busy fighting what we call real crime. I mean, you know, DUIs, you know, murders, all that big stuff. They just don't have the time for fireworks. And so I guess that would be my challenge to you is, how are you going to enforce this law should it pass? The other point that I would like to make is my groups were wonderfully responsible last year in voluntarily closing down their fireworks stands. They were given the option of what they wanted to do. And I guess I would just like to point out that they all chose the right thing to do. And so I would ask you guys to have some trust and faith in your own community in making their own decisions and making the right decisions. The other point I would like to bring up is, as far as possession, I know Mr. Farley spoke about it a little bit. It would seem silly to me to pass a law that the police could enforce at their discretion. What are we teaching our children? That just doesn't make sense to me. So. Thank you very much for your time.
Thanks, Becky, for being here tonight.
Thank you.
Jay Young, how are you this evening?
Good, thank you. Jay Young, I live at 2105 Yarrow, and I'm speaking in favor of the ban on fireworks. I believe in the basic common good of the people, and obviously, it showed last year when the ban was in place, so the emergency ban. People will follow the right path, and I think if you impose this ban, people will stay with it. They'll understand the consequences. The neighbors I've talked to, the people I've talked to, they're in favor of this. Coming down out of the evacuation last year off of the where we live, it's very scary when you're involved in that. And we have lived in a house before on the east side where fireworks were coming in over the fences and the yards. And it's a scary time. And I have seen the damage that it can do to kids. Forget the fires. There is damage to individuals. They can get hurt with these, whether you're a professional football player or person next door. So I am in favor of the ban. Thank you.
Thanks, Jay. Thank you for being here this evening. All right, how are we doing? Are we about done with public comment? Anybody else wish to address the council on the fireworks ban at this time? Seeing no other takers at this point, I will turn it over to the city council for any action they may wish to take. Or...
I have a request.
Yes, sir.
I'm sure we're all going to have a lot to say, and I, for one, could use a five-minute break.
All right. So we'll take a 3.5-minute restroom break. All right, 5-minute break.
And 3.5, we'll get there.
And then we'll restart the public. We can reconvene the public hearing regarding fireworks, and this would be a time where we would turn it over to the city council for their comments or any actions or motions they would like to take. If you wanted to get a motion on the table in a second, we could have discussion, or we can do discussion first, whatever.
Well, Your Honor, to put something on the floor here, I'll make a motion, and if I get a second, then I'd like to speak to the motion. And my motion is to adopt ordinance 2016-10, an ordinance regulating the sale, possession, and use of fireworks, and repealing prior ordinances number 2638, 2000-15 at 1, and 2014-8 at 1.
Second.
A motion by Councilmember Kulas and a second by Councilmember Harold to adopt ordinance 2016-10 as presented in your packet. Discussion? Who would like to lead that?
Well, Your Honor, since I made the motion, I'll take that privilege. And I wanted to remind us all that the various email communications we received are part of the record. And I honestly, I'm not sure if we all received what we all received. I, for example, received an email from Judy Connor that was addressed more personally to me. And I don't know if that was, you know, to you as well, but.
We did our best to get, if I got them, to get them out. I'm not sure that I could have got them all out, but we did the best we could, so.
And what I have to say, and I will try to be brief, which is unusual for me. I don't normally publicly push hard on issues. That doesn't mean that I don't push hard on issues, I just publicly. This one, though, I am. And the whole basis of my support for the ordinance as presented to us is that this is about fire and it's about public safety. It's not about fireworks. It's about fire and public safety. We are striving to become a more FireWise community. And if you've spent any time on the FireWise.org website, there are wonderful ways to protect our homes and properties from fire prevention. We are making significant tax dollar expenditures in the area of becoming more FireWise, resourcing our staff. I believe Mr. King was back at the National Fire Academy. You'll recall that we've done some rehabilitation work, not only seeding, but drainage work post-fires. We've had a number of fires, natural and man-caused, threatening our community. I look at this as just eliminating one potential source of ignition that causes issues, just one source, but a large one. And yes, we do have firework-related fires. Let's not forget just a couple of years ago, the fire that raced up below Saddle Rock and Old Butte, the Deals property on Skyline. I spoke with former Fire Chief Stan Smoke, and he put it this way, that a lot of the fires that were created by fireworks weren't significant enough to make media sources. And as he put it, we dodged the bullet a lot of times. Your neighbor's arborvitae's catching on and someone being able to put it out, or the department making a quick response. Some of you have been perplexed by the mail that was in your mailbox, and I'm going to go through it with you. I recently finished a term on the State Building Code Council, and I worked on that council with City of Spokane Fire Marshal, who provided me some information in an email, and in particular statistics. And I just wanted you to just take a look at a couple of these in this printout of the PowerPoint presentation. This is a recent presentation, 2015, that they updated. And you see in the City of Spokane, for that June 28 to July 6 period, which is the state fireworks period, that for the 10 years leading up to the ban in Spokane in 1993, that they had a little over 1,000 fireworks-related fires that occurred during that block of time, each of those 10 years. In the 10 years following the ban, 46 fires. So you've gone from 1,043 to 46 total. So that's 100 a year to four, almost five a year. And on the next page, you see that the graphic changes to a 20-year period after the ban, and still just 93 fires, less than 100.
The page three is predictable that if they kept on that trend, they'd be close to 2,000 fires over the 10-year period. But here's something significant that was just presented to us tonight, and that has to do with injuries, the fireworks-related injuries. Requiring emergency room treatment in Spokane area hospitals, and they do track where these came from. In the 10-year period leading up to the ban, 290 related emergency room treatments. In the 10-year period afterwards, 37. That's a significant drop in injuries. And then the following chart does the 20-year, so you've gone from an average of 28 a year for the 10 years leading up to the ban to less than or an average of about 5 per year for the 20 years afterwards. And their bottom lines, if I could just meet some of these, not only reduce fire calls, reduce trauma, but reduce noise, nuisance, trash. I like this one, reduce need for residents to stay home for 4th of July holiday with hoses ready to protect their property. The other piece of information that I provided to you is the picture of a Stimmelt grower's cherry box that I provided there. Mm-hmm. And this is the fire that swept into Broadview is credited with igniting the warehouse district fire. Mm-hmm. Okay, it's approximately 1.5 miles between those areas. And we have found that once building materials catch on fire, they travel differently and cause are more of a source of ignition than, say, brush and tree crowning. This box was in a tree, singed in a tree outside my offices at the base of 19th Street in East Wenatchee, which is, coincidentally, 1.5 miles from the Stimmelt plant. So picture a community with embers going and had this ignited, and we know that the Apple Capitol Loop Trail on the east side is more rustic and more natural with a lot of dried grasses. So again, it's not fireworks, it's fire. This was 1.5 miles, and if we look at the assessed valuation of our community, which Mr. King tells me is about $2.5 billion, I mean, that's what we do with fire or hazard statistics, is what's at risk. Mm-hmm. $2.5 billion in assessed value that we might be willing to give up, again, for a source of ignition. I think that the email that we received from Dr. Lapo was one of the more significant ones I liked, or that struck home with me, and that was her comment about, and this was fireworks related, that it's very disconcerting to awaken early in the morning to the scent of smoke and realize that you're hearing helicopters only to discover that you can see active flames from your home. So in addition to the fire and property destruction, you have trauma to our citizens and our pets. I do appreciate the groups that sell fireworks to raise money, and insofar as I did my homework, so to speak. The State Fire Marshal's Office provides a listing of the communities that have bans. As Mr. Smith indicated, this is near duplicate of the city of Spokane. Spokane County bans them. In fact, in Spokane, only Airway Heights, Deer Park, and Medical Lake are communities that don't ban them. At any rate, I went to check on, were there similar groups in those communities? And they're raising money. So there's church groups, there's political action groups, they're raising monies. And so it wouldn't be that difficult, having a year to transition into another method of fundraising, to check with peer groups in no farther than the city of Chelan. The city of Chelan has a fireworks ban. But Moses Lake, Yakima, Pasco, the Spokane communities, Pasco, I mentioned them. Almost the entire county, Yakima County communities do that. So there's resources out there for folks to check to see how did they make up that fundraising. This issue has been before the city during my tenure, 13 years, more than 13 years. When the mayor and I first ran for council, it was an issue. And I used to make a wisecrack that I don't think is very funny anymore. And that was simply, the only question about banning fireworks is, do you do it before the town burns down or after? And I thought that had some humor until last year. And I just think it's time to step up. It's okay to be the first. Our community was the first to hold the Apple Blossom Festival. It's okay to be first. And now East Wenatchee has got other activities going on associated with that same weekend. So it's okay to be first. And it's okay to allow our enforcement officers discretion. They do it many times, whether people are speeding. I don't know about the hands-free calling stuff, but they're very talented. So I'll quit chatting about it and just say that I think that while the direct destruction is obvious, it's we have to consider the indirect costs, the fear, the stress as well, and know that we're not alone in that.
Thank you, Councilmember Kulas. Who is next? Anybody else wish to say a few words before we vote?
I will.
Yeah, go ahead, Ruth.
So I just want everyone to know, and most of the council knows, that I was evacuated last year from that fire. That fire came within 50 feet of my home. I saw my neighbor's homes burn down. So I understand the trauma behind it and how it left my neighbors whose homes were burned down. However, while it is reasonable that people who lived through that want some sort of ordinance to, you know, alleviate some of those nerves and potentially even reduce the risk of fires, although not all fires are caused by fireworks, we need to have an ordinance that is sensible. And what I mean by that is that I have an issue with the possession word in there. And I understand that, you know, people are saying that it's discretionary for the police. Well, I have an issue with that too, because either you enforce or you don't enforce. And to me, if it's an element of this ordinance, it needs to be enforced. With that said, though, you may be enforcing something on somebody who had no intention to light up fireworks in this town. Like I gave my example, somebody may just be driving through or just going home, you know, before they leave town to go maybe right behind again to, you know, monitor Cashmere to light up fireworks because it's not banned regionally. But even if it was banned regionally, I would still have an issue with this word possession. Because again, you could just be driving through and you could potentially be liable. And not just liable like a traffic ticket. There is criminal consequences here. The last thing I want is to see people being criminally punished when they're innocent. And because of that, unless we take that word out, I am not for this ordinance as it is written.
Anybody else wish to address the audience or let their opinions known before we vote?
Yes.
Okay.
So I learned a lot last year about fireworks. And one of the things that I learned is that making something illegal doesn't stop it from continuing to happen. I used the example last year of being in Moses Lake during 4th of July, who's had a ban for 7 to 8 years. And there were so many illegal fireworks going off that we couldn't find the city's display. All we could see was the public's personal illegal display. I don't know what's right. I do know that it seems wrong to take away the rights of some people who would use them safely, but we are also aware that a lot of people don't use them safely. One of the things I pushed last year was we need to educate people. And I think that happened last year. We educated people rapidly and asked them not to use fireworks. And for the most part, they didn't. I was very disappointed that the one person who received a ticket last year was able to go to court and get it forgiven. There's no sense in having a law if we're not going to enforce them, and the courts aren't going to stand behind us and enforce them. So that's a very frustrating thing. As far as the possession is concerned, the one thing I have to say there is if we're going to ban fireworks, it makes it much easier for our law enforcement to enforce something if we have something as simple as possession, because it's going to be impossible for them to catch somebody in the act every time. It's a tough issue again. So as much as I am against banning fireworks, I can say that I work for the citizens of Wenatchee, and overwhelmingly the responses we got from the citizens were asking us to enforce this ban. I don't know that it's going to work, but if we do it and it doesn't work, then we have other options. So I, for one, will be voting for it against my own personal beliefs because the citizens have asked us to.
Anybody else? Councilmember Bailey or?
Yeah, I appreciate, Keith, your statement there. I too got a lot of emails and phone calls, and people stopped me in the store and, you know, that kind of thing. And Mark's comment, I think, Councilmember Kulas's comment, that this is about fire safety and not fireworks. I think I think it really frames what we're really about here. We're dealing with risk, and I'm, you know, people have talked about tradition, and I appreciate that. There was no bigger fan of blowing things up than me. I lived on the reservation, and I had access to some really nice stuff. Even the stuff that they weren't supposed to be selling, I was blowing up.
There is a statute of limitations.
There is a statute of limitations. Yeah. And I appreciate all of that. I mean, that was part of childhood and the fourth every year and whatever. But I will say this, that times change and circumstances change. I came to Wenatchee in 1969, and there was about 17,000 people in the city of Wenatchee then. It's more than doubled. And can, you know, look at the county area. It's a much denser place. There's a lot more opportunity. For me, it's about risk. And now you can make the case that you can walk across the street and get hit by a bus. Okay, but I think it's prudent to be able to do what we can to reduce the potential risk of these kinds of fires. And I will say, in all honesty, when I talk about safe and sane fireworks, sparkler that's burning at 2,000 degrees Fahrenheit, I find, in giving it to a five-year-old child, I find neither safe nor sane. But as a custodian of this city, I look at this from the standpoint of taking a look at where we can do something that will help, hopefully help. And I'm like Keith, I'm like you. There's no guarantees how this is all going to turn out. We had great response last year. I'm not sure that would hold this year. We were coming off, the smoke was still in the air last year when everybody said, maybe we shouldn't do this. We're a year down the road from that. I'm not sure we'd get that same kind of response a year down the road. So I think I'm going to vote for it. I think this is something that is a matter of prudence on the part of our of this city to do what we can to reduce any potential risk out there for many of these kinds of fires that can do the kind of damage that we saw.
Thank you, Councilmember Bailey. Councilman Markhart, you wish to say anything, or nope. Mike or Linda, anybody?
I do. Okay. I will be voting in favor of this, and the reason why I concur with what Councilmember Kulas has said, do we do it now or do we wait until after the fire? And, you know, there is that huge potential there. Last year when the fire happened, it came right down to my backyard and stopped right there at the canal. And I had to evacuate, and I didn't know if I had a home until the next morning. So I agree it's about fire safety,
and what we can do to prevent fires. I also have a huge personal issue with the fireworks. I have a surrogate son who's missing a portion of his thumb, and his parents didn't even know he had it. I don't understand a parent who would put a firecracker in a child's hand. I just don't get it. And I don't like going to Riverfront Park to try and sit and watch the fireworks when little kids are running up behind me with firecrackers throwing them at my back. So yeah, let's do something about it and let's do the best we can to protect our community against that potential fire hazard.
Thank you, Councilmember Harold.
Well, I think all I can say is that I had a juniper bush once that Whistling Pete took out. So much for safe and sane.
Councilmember Poyer, you wish to say anything?
I know the safeties, the issue, a lot of the issues, all these are obviously very valid points. It's very hard with the possession. I worry about that. I'm scared about that. I also believe I have to vote based on the people of the city of Wenatchee and what their responses are as a majority. I feel responsible to do that. I also look at the money. I call myself a money guy, and I worry about resources. I worry about what we're spending to go chase down, even if it didn't burn it out in a house, it chases the fire people over to spend the money to go do that. It chases the police officers to go determine, was it possession or was he actually using the fireworks, I guess. I did enjoy Shiloh when she made the comments that she's encouraging, I believe it's not just nonprofit organizations to come down and to help supplement that income that they're gonna lose. That really bothers me, and I like that solution. And I think if anything, if this gets approved, we should look at more things like that to help with the organizations that did lose some money because of what we're doing if we pass this.
Okay. I will just make one comment and then I'll call for the question. For me, and I think things have changed. Before I was mayor, you know, you'd hear the sirens going and you would go there, you know, we got now I hear them, and every time they run an intersection running code, going someplace to do something good, our law enforcement personnel, or our firefighters, they're putting not only themselves at risk, but anybody that's in that intersection, because what they do is dangerous. And again, every time I hear a siren now with the mayor hat, it's which one of our people are out there working for us and doing that work. And the fewer times, things that we can do to make that happen, the fewest amount of times, the better I'll sleep at night. For me, it's a public safety issue, and I've been in favor of a ban for a while, and it's mostly because of the men wearing the blue and the white that do that for us. The fewer times we can have them running, the safer they are and the safer our streets are. That being said, we had a motion and a second.
I just want to make one more comment.
Sure.
I failed to mention. Somebody brought up the idea of explosions that are causing animal stress and things like that. I want to remind everybody that education is still going to be critical here. Mm-hmm. Anything that goes up in the air, anything that explodes is already illegal. Not only in the state of Washington, but in our city. Our city has always had a more restrictive firework code than the state of Washington. And yet we've all seen and heard what goes on in our city. So we still need to educate. We still need to be proactive. If we see our neighbors shooting something off that's going to cause a fire, we need to be on the telephone letting our people know. So. Mm-hmm.
All right. Thank you. So a motion and a second. Discussion is finished. All those in favor of the ordinance, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
So we have 6 in favor, 1 against. Motion carries. So last item, I would like to do, let's do the council member stuff first before I give the mayor's report. So if there's any council business they'd like to talk about.
Lodging Tax Advisory Committee meets next Wednesday at 3 p.m. right here.
Okay. Any other council items going on?
Just 2 quick things. Just a reminder on AWSC conference, if anybody needs to get that taken care of here, Allison or Tammy will ship.
Make reservations and then.
Do we need any voting representatives today?
We do need voting representatives, so we need to find out who's going.
We probably could, at least by our next
yes.
meeting, the 20s, whatever.
Okay, the next public meeting we yes. can do it?
Yeah.
Okay, great.
Yeah. Oh, okay. So okay. we need to do that. Chardon?
No, I'm on the jury for the Governor's Smart Communities Awards that are presented there, and I don't know if I'm supposed to.
Okay.
I have a meeting before then, so I'll be able to know.
Okay.
By our next regular meeting.
All right, good.
Anything else, yep. council members?
Ruth and I are changing a committee.
Okay. June 20th, so once you get that changed officially, let us know and we'll update it and pass that in a consent item next time.
Like last week of June.
Anything else? So I do have one announcement to make this evening. After about a four-week process of interviewing a number of different officers to be our next chief of police, earlier this week, we have hired, I think on Wednesday, we got a written agreement from our new police chief, who happens to be in the audience today as he flew over from the Olympia area. So Steve Crown is going to be our next chief of police. He's back in the room. Come on up, Steve. I will say a few little things about him. For those of you that don't know Steve, he's got 25 years. Where's he sit down first? So he's got 25 years in law enforcement. He's got a bachelor's degree in criminal justice. He actually worked for the City of Wenatchee Police Department for 11 years and then went on to have a 14-year career with the Washington State Department of Fish and Wildlife. He's been the chief there for the last 3 years, and we are looking forward to getting he and his wife Kim moved over here. She's a school teacher, and looking forward to having him start, I think, sometime in the middle of June. So my pleasure to introduce Steve Crown, and if you just say a few words and you come up and say hello to the council members, and I'll adjourn the meeting. So I'll kind of turn it over to you, Steve.
Well, thank you, Mayor. I'm excited to be here. Long process, they always are, but that's a good thing. You properly vet your next leader within the community. It's always a good thing when you could come to this day. I'm excited to get started. Got a lot of things to wrap up back at our state's capital. And, with any organization, you want to leave Washington Department of Fish and Wildlife Police in some good hands. So I'll be starting that process. But at the same time, I'll be making connections with externally and internally with the police department. And I look forward to getting to meet all of you and talk about Wenatchee's future and how I can help. So thank you.
Steve, we're excited you're here tonight.
Welcome.
And welcome aboard. Welcome and come up and say hi to the council. And with that, tonight's meeting is adjourned.